to thank Andreas for inviting me, and I also like to thank Yeonjin for organizing this conference. I personally have never seen any organizer who works as hard as she does. So, the title of my talk is The Cerebral Integral. And Young Books. This is joint work with Suho Oh, who is a postdoc at University of Michigan currently. So the Cerebral Integral can be written in this way. It has three parameters, alpha, beta, and gamma, and it's a multiple integral like this. This was first evaluated by Selberg in 1944, 70 years ago, and it has a very nice product formula like this. Actually, if you look at this, then you may think this is complicated, but you don't need to remember this formula. All you need to remember is that this is a nice product formula. So product formula in terms of gamma function. So when the parameters are integers, then this can be written as product of factorials. Okay. So it's a Selberg integral, and is all you need to remember is that this is a nice, very nice product formula. Okay, you don't need to remember the formula. So when the exponents here, alpha minus 1, beta minus 1, and 2 gamma, when these exponents are non-negative integers, and there is a combinatorial interpretation of this Selberg integral. So when these alpha minus 1, beta minus 1, 2 gamma, when these are non-negative integers, say non-negative integers, then there is a combinatorial interpretation. So today, I'm going to give you a combinatorial interpretation of the Selberg integral, and then I will introduce Selberg books and Young books, and Young books are related to standard Young tableau. And for simplicity, in this talk, we will assume that this alpha equals 1, beta equals 1. That means we are going to ignore the first two factors. In this talk, alpha equals 1, beta equals 1, and 2, gamma equals m, which is an integer. Okay? We will assume this situation. Although we assume that alpha equals 1, beta equals 1, everything that I'm going to talk today can be applied to general alpha and beta integers. Okay? But for simplicity, we will assume this. So the first part is a combinatorial interpretation. This is due to Richard Stanley, and actually it can be found in his book Enumerative Combinatorics, Volume 1, second edition. Exercise 1.10 of B. So you can find this combinatorial interpretation there. But I'm going to review this combinatorial interpretation. So in the Selberg integral, we assume that alpha equals 1, beta equals 1. So you can forget about those two factors. And then if you look at the third factor, you can see that's actually a Vandermonde determinant, power of Vandermonde determinant. So the Selberg integral, let me just write that, Selberg integral. Zagreb integral is actually equal to these are gone. We don't have this anymore. And if you look at this, this is an absolute value. So if you change exchange xi and xj, the integral is still the same. In other words, it's symmetrical in all the variables x1 through xn. So we can say that n factorial 0 x1 is smaller than x2 dot 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 xn. We can assume this situation because these are symmetrical in xy in all the variables. You can write something like this: dm and dx1 dxn. This is, you can say something like this. And now, this is equal to, okay, this right over here. This can be now written as a probability of certain event. So it's n factorial is the same as here. And probability that, so pick x, this is real, these are real numbers. Pick random real numbers which are ordered in this way, randomly. This n a I j k, where I less than j and k from 1 to m, this m. And we pick these a bunch of real numbers randomly, at least also between 0 and 1, randomly, and compute the probability that aij k is between, for every ij k, this is between xi and xj. This is the probability. And this is equal to the integral here. The reason why we have this probability expression is that, so suppose x1 through xn are fixed. So x1 here, x1 is here, x2 like this, xn. So you can see xi and xj somewhere like, let's say xi is over here, and xj is like this. And then now you pick a random number from 0 to 1. And what is the probability that this random number is between xi and xj? That's exactly the length of this interval, xj minus xi. So once xi's are fixed, the probability that this number is between xi and xj is just the absolute value of their difference. And this is, for each I, we have to pick m random numbers, and they are all inside this interval, so we have this kind of probability expression. Okay? So that's a brief explanation of this probability. And now that we have this probability, we can now work with only permutations, not just real numbers, things like that. And that is equal to this one, n factorial. Let me first write and then explain. This is what I'm going to call so this is a set of certain permutation related to this n plus m n choose 2 factorial divided by n factorial. Here n plus m times n choose 2 is the number of letters here. So there are n letters for x's, and there are m times n choose 2 letters for a's. So this is basically probability. And here, this sb, here where sb of n comma m is a set of permutations of these letters, Now we think of them as letters, not a real number, not as real numbers. X1, dot, 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 Xn, and Aij, super k, for, such that, yeah, the same thing, like, this is located between Xi and Xj. Aij, Aij, k. A13, super 2. A12, super 2. So this is an example of a permutation in this set, 3, 2. Now you can see x1, x2, x2, x3, they are in this increasing order. And for any a, for instance this, you look at the subscript, it's a sub 1, 2, that means this is between x1 and x2. It is between x1 and x2. And also here, this is also between x1 and x2. This is between x1 and x3, x1 and x3. This is between x2 and x3, etc. So this is an example. And permutations of this form are those in this set. All right? Okay. Now, I'm going to represent this permutation in a slightly different way, which I will call a Selberg books. Selberg books are object. These are basically a filling of certain Ferris diagram, shifted Ferris diagram. So a permutation, we will consider a permutation pi in this set n comma m as a filling of this. So shifted staircase, something like this, and the size of this is n, and there are n copies of this. N. And there are m copies of this, and we are going to fill the cells with integers, 1, 2, 3, dot, dot, dot. And there is a condition here. These are the main diagonals. These are main diagonal entries. I'm going to say something like this. Diagonals identified. And for every non-diagonal cell, so this is a non-diagonal, these are non-diagonals except those in the main diagonal. For any non-diagonal cell, so for instance, say something like here, say A. We have a non-diagonal cell here, and then you compare this with the diagonal cell in the same row. So let's say this is B, and you look at the diagonal cell in the same column, say C. Then the condition is that this number is smaller than this and bigger than this. This is the condition. Actually, I have an example of Selberg book, so this will help you understand the definition. So diagonals are identified. That means this cell is the same as, so if you have one more, is this, these three are the same, these three are the same, etc. Okay, so here is an example of Selberg book. N is the size of each staircase, so 1, 2, 3, 4, N equals 4, and M is basically the number of pages in this book, so 1, 2, 3, so M equals 3, and then if you look at this, I have made holes. So it's always, you can always see these diagonal entries if you flip this over. Okay. So diagonal cells, what I mean by diagonal cells identified is this. Diagonal cells, they share the diagonal cells. Like that. Okay. So for every page, you look at non-diagonal cell. For instance, this, 10. This is bigger than the diagonal cell in the same row. So 10 is bigger than 1. And you look at the diagonal entry in the same column. 17 is bigger than 10. So it has satisfied this condition. For every non-diagonal cell, this condition must be hold. Like that. So this is an example of cell-borne integral. But for non-diagonal cells themselves, there are no relations between them. This is could be bigger than this or smaller than this. So we only compare non-diagonal cells and diagonal cells. Okay?
What about the ones on the diagonal?
They must be increasing. And that's a corollary of this condition. Because, you know, this is bigger than, smaller than this, if you compare this. Diagonal cells are actually increasing always. And that follows from this condition. Okay. Now, this is really the same as this filling, if you look at carefully. So let me give you a correspondence between the two objects. So example. So here we have this Elbaug, this permutation, and this is in fact the same as this filling. So n is the size of each staircase, m is the number of pages. Like this. Okay. I'm going to make a correspondence between this and this. And let me write down the positions of each letter. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So that means we are going to use integers 1 through 9. And we are going to fill these cells with integers 1 through 9. And diagonal, for diagonal entries, this will be the position of x1. The position of x1 is 1, so we fill this with 1. And then for the second diagonal entry, this is the position of x2. Position of x2 is 5, so it's 5. This is the position of x3, which is 9. And because diagonals are identified, we can fill this with like that. And this is the position of, this is the 1, 2 cell, and it's the first page, so it's going to be the position of A12 super 1. A12 super 1 is 4. So it's gonna be 4. And this is the position of A13 super 1. What is that? 6. And A23 super 1 is 7. Like that. And then A12 super 2 3. A13 super 2 is 2. A23 super 2 8. So you can see this is a bijection, and permutations like this are really can be identified with filling like this. Okay. So these are cell bug books. And now if you look at this, this is very similar to what we already know, standard Young tableau, shifted standard Young tableau. So let me define Let me define Young books. So definition, we have already defined Selberg books, and I'm going to define NM. So this is N comma M Selberg book. It's called N comma NM Selberg. And NM Young book is that's a special Selberg book. So an N comma N Young book is a Selberg book, NM Selberg book with additional condition. In which such that integers are increasing, entries are increasing along rows and columns. Rows and columns. So, special Selberg books. So this is not a This is a Selberg book, but it's not a Young book because the first page is okay. It's increasing. But here, this in the, if you look at the first row, it's not increasing in the first row. So it's, this is a Selberg book, it's not, but not a Young book. Okay. Example. Oh, and YB of n comma m is a set of Young NM Young books. An example is, what is YB of n comma 1? We have only one page, so this is exactly the shifted Young tableau of set of shifted standard Young tableau of shape this. This is something that we already know. Okay, what about Young book of n comma 2? Now we have two pages. Is this also a known object? Indeed, yes, it is also a very well-known object. It's just the standard Young tableau of square shape. Do you see why? So here, suppose that that's a Young book. And then diagonals are identified. So you flip the second page over like this, and then you can attach two pages along the diagonal, then you get this. So this is the first page. This is the second page. If you attach them along the diagonal, then this standard Young tableau. So for m equals 1 or 2, these are a well-known object. But for m equals 3 or bigger, then new. So m is bigger than or 3, then it's a new object. So m equals 3, for instance, then here we have another page. It's something like this. But it's hard to draw, so these are definitions. And now we have two objects, Selberg integrals and Selberg books and Young books. They don't, it seems like they are not quite related. They have, but the thing is, there's a very nice relation between their cardinalities. So the theorem is here's a theorem. The cardinality of the Selberg book is equal to the cardinality of Young books times a very simple factor like 1 factorial, 2 factorial, dot, dot, dot. There is a very nice formula like relation between them like this. Actually, moreover, let me first write and then explain. We can fix the diagonal entries. Suppose we fix the diagonal entries and then consider only Selberg books with given diagonal entries. So d1, dot, 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 dn minus 1, this is equal to and with the same factor here. Even we fix the diagonals, they have the same relation. So here, what this means is that, so just look at just the diagonal entries. Suppose the diagonal entries are a1, a2, dot, 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 an. Then d means the integers between the consecutive diagonal entries. So di means ai plus 1 minus ai minus 1. So it's the number of integers between the two consecutive diagonal entries. So here you can see we have only n minus 1 numbers over here. So if you know this, then you can recover the diagonal entries because this is always 1. This is 1, and this is d1, this plus d1 plus 1, and you can continuously add. Yeah, for instance here, d1 is the number of entries, number of integers between 1 and 5, which is 3, etc. Okay, so they have a very nice formula like this, and I'm going to show you how to show you the proof. Proof is not that hard, in fact. Before proving this, let me give you an example. It's a trivial example in some sense. Let's just look at one page, m equals 1 case. And suppose here we have Selberg book with one page, and here we have Young book. Suppose we fix the diagonal entries like 1, 5, 8, 10. 1, 5, 8, 10. So the theorem says that the number of Selberg integrals with this diagonal entry is equal to the number of Young books with these diagonal entries times 1 factorial, 2 factorial, 3 factorial. And can you see that from this example? Now let's construct a Young book with this diagonal entry. Here we don't have any choice. We have to fill this with 9 because 9 is the only integer between these two. And here we have two entries and we have only two integers are available, 6 and 7. So you don't have any choice. Actually, it's fixed. There's only one. The number of Young books is only one here. And similarly here, this must be 9 because this is the only integer between here and here. And here, we must have 6 and 7 in the second row because it cannot go because if it's not, if you have something not 6 or 7, that will be bigger, smaller than 5. And similarly here, it's 2, 3, 4. But they can be, for each row, they can be, integers can be permuted in any way. So it's 1 factorial, 2 factorial, 3 factorial. So if you fix the diagonal entries like this, then this is true. But the theorem, what the theorem says is that for any choice of diagonal entries, we have this relation, which is non-trivial at all. Okay, and then proof is, unfortunately, proof is not bijective. We found a generating function for both sides and then show that they have this kind of relation. So I'm going to show you the generating function for the left-hand side. So the proposition we sum over all possible choices of these. There are no non-negative integers. And then we compute the set times t1, d1, tn minus 1, dn minus 1, the exponential generating function. We want to compute this generating function, and in fact, it has a very nice product formula. Like, very simple. So we want to show this proposition. So the generating function is very simple. By the way, if you look at the right, left-hand side, this is not, this doesn't look like a polynomial with integer coefficient, because we have something in the denominator. But if you look at this carefully, think about it a little bit, then you see this is indeed an integer. For any d1, dn, this divided by this factorial is always an integer. Do you see that? Why we have an integer? Why is this divisible by this? The reason is, okay. So, it's a1, a2, a3, a4, a5. So here the number of integers between a2 and a3 is d2. So number of integers between a1 and a2 is d1, etc. Okay? d1, if you multiply d1, if you... So there are d1 integers between this and this. All right? But if you permute those, then you still have the condition over there still holds. Because we only compare non-diagonal entries and diagonal entries. And everything on the non-diagonal entry for D1 entries, they are all less than A1 and A2. If you permute those, you still get have the same relation. Maybe I can give you an example. So what I'm going to do is the following. So from that observation, I'm going to make a simpler object, simpler than the Selberg books. So, example. So, 1, 3, 1, 3, 2, 9. So we have a Selberg book like this, and I'm going to change this into a new object, simpler object, as follows. So let's say this is interval 1. Interval 1, and this is interval 2, this is interval 3. Okay. Now I'm going to leave diagonal entries empty. I'm not going to care for the diagonal entries. For non-diagonal entries, for each non-diagonal entry, if that number is in interval, say ith interval, then I'm going to fill this with t sub I. So here, 3 is in the first interval, 2, 1, between 1 and 4. So I'm going to change this into t1. This means this is there was an integer in this interval. And this is also in the first interval, so it's t1. 9 is in the third interval, so it's t3. This 5 is in the second interval, t2. Now 8 is in the third interval, t3. And the t3, like this. Okay? Of course, we lost some information, but This is not a one-to-one map, but it is d1 factorial dot dot dot. You can easily see that this is the many-to-one map. Many thing goes to this. And that's nothing like that. So the left-hand side is in fact the generating function for this. So the left-hand side is the generating function for this. Actually, we are almost done for the proof. I think now I can use this board again. So the proof. Left-hand side is the generating function for This is ordinary generating function for this object. Oh. I'm sorry, this cannot be true. This proposition cannot be true. Because, you know, we have M here. M is missing. Actually, M is, should be here. But I'm going to only assume M equals 1 case. It's the same. For general M, it's the same. So let's just say it's 1. For general M, we all you need to do is to raise this to the nth power. But anyway. All right. Something like this. Generate function for this. Diagonal entries are empty. For each non-diagonal entry, we're going to fill this with integers. TIs. So for, say, suppose that this is in the ith row and jth column, there are several choices. Here, this could be ti or ti plus 1, I plus 1 up to tj minus 1. Okay? Here, you know what I mean. So, for every non-diagonal entry, we have these many choices. So, if you pick I less two integers I less than j, then that means you choose one non-diagonal entry. And for this non-diagonal entry, you have these many choices. So basically, that's the proof. So just a brief explanation for the proof. And now we want to compute the generating function for the Young books. The proposition. Now we need to compute the generating function for Young books. Again, just say m equals 1 case. The same generating function. In fact, now these coefficients are no longer integers. Coefficients are rational numbers now. But it has also a very nice formula. The same thing in the denominator, numerator, j minus I. This is it. There is a nice formula like this. And if you look at the denominator here, then you can see this is actually 1 factorial, 2 factorial, dot dot dot, n minus 1 factorial. So, and the proof, I have very small room over here, but I can prove one line. Proof is by one line. You can imagine it's a known result. It's not done by Alex Postnikov. He proved this theorem, this result, using Gelfand-Zetterlin-Politov. He evaluated the volume of the Gelfand-Zetterlin-Politov in two different ways. And his proof is not combinatorial. He used like a Weyl dimension formula, things like that. But it's true, he proved it. So we have these two propositions, and these two propositions imply the theorem when m equals 1. But for general m, you can do it by looking at each page. So I'm not going to prove for general m. But the thing is, the important thing is, the essential part is m equals 1 case. Once m equals 1 case is done, for general m, it's easy. So proof, the theorem is proved. Okay, now some corollaries. We can say something. At the beginning of this talk, I mentioned that Selberg integral, evaluating the Selberg integral, is more or less the same as computing the cardinality of Selberg books, N.M. Selberg books. And this N.M. Selberg books are related to N.M. Young books. That means you can compute the cardinality of Young books using Selberg integrals. So these are corollaries. Corollary. Young books, the cardinality of Young books is equal to, now everything is factorials or double factorial, because gamma functions changes into factorials. Here, double factorial means for even integers, double factorial is the product of even numbers less than or equal to that number. And for odd numbers, is the product of odd integers less than 3. Okay, so we have a corollary. This is we know this because this is related to Young Selberg books and related to Selberg integral, and we know how to, the formula is known, so we obtain this. So some curl, and let me not where is this. And in that corollary, we know that when m equals 1, we get standard Young, shifted standard Young tableau. M equals 2, we get standard Young tableau of scale shape. And for shifted or standard Young tableau, the formula for any shape, there is a formula called hook length formula. So we can compare the theorem, the corollary, when m equals 1 or 2 with hook length formula. So YB of N1, then we get a hook length formula. Hook length formula. This is, if you compute that formula right there, and you need to cancel some terms in the numerator and denominator, but after some cancellation, you get something equivalent to hook length formula. For this shape. And also m equals 2 case, this is equivalent to hook length formula for scale shape. But of course when m is bigger than 2, there are no hook length formula known, so we can recover hook length formula for shifted shape, staircase and scale shape from that corollary. Okay. Actually, I have said most of what I wanted to say. So let me finish my talk with some open problems. The original motivation of our work is to prove the Selberg integral formula combinatorially. We wanted to find a combinatorial proof of the Selberg integral formula, but we haven't succeeded yet. But maybe this idea can be hopefully useful to prove it combinatorially. So some open problems. Problem number one. So this is the main theorem of my talk, and like I said, the proof is not combinatorial, so it will be interesting because the formula is very nice. Both are completely combinatorial object. The formula is, the relation is very simple, so it will be very interesting to find the combinatorial proof. Bijective proof, something like that. combinatorial proof of the theorem right there. And then also find the combinatorial proof of this corollary, the number of Young books of the corollary. Once you proved both problem number 1 and 2, then you have a combinatorial proof for the Seelberg integral formula. Of course, there could be a different way. I only made it, I could have been made it more difficult because I changed one problem into two problems. But anyway, there is a question, it's very common question, Q analog. So once we have a nice formula, it's very common to ask for Q analogs. That means generalize by putting a parameter Q. And there are many Q Seelberg integrals, so it will be interesting to see if some of these idea can be applied to other Q Seelberg integrals. And I think that's all. Thank you very much.